तरप तरप सगरी रे गुजरी कौन देश गयो सांवरिया उबल आए अखियां मधुवारे तरक तरक गए चुनरिया
Initially, under the Mughals, you had Delhi as the seat of culture, the place where khayal singing actually crystallized into a form. But with the fall of the Mughals, the axis of power, at least in the cultural space, shifted to Lucknow, and then the whole Awadh region became the steaming center for cultural growth.
Tarap tarap sagri rain gujri कौन देश गयो सांवरिया
With the fall of Awadh, lot of tertiary centers like Banaras, Calcutta started developing as centers of patronage.
Calcutta emerged as the cultural capital of this country with the movement of Nawab Wajid Ali Shah in exile. Because he moved in exile with 160 musicians and dancers. And the British government paid for the maintenance of all that entourage of his. So Calcutta, as a result, became the home of instrumental music. Calcutta became the home of the Thumri. And there was a very strong backing for music amongst the aristocracy of Bengal.
Because the Jamindars themselves were not only rich patrons of music, but they were musicians also, so many of them. Not to forget the musicians that they kept in their house. The music that is so much present now are all due to the gift of these people from a century back.
Especially under, you know, royal patronage or aristocratic patronage, there was no one set norm for a musical performance. Many of these patrons who would want very long and elaborate expositions, very so-called classical pieces of rendition, they would ensure that that sort of entertainment is provided to them. Whereas a lot of them wanted something flippant and light, and that also the musicians had to perform.
It was a patron-performer relationship after all, and it was an intimate relationship. You did not have the distance of a proscenium theatre. Also, it must have been a more participatory experience that the connoisseur or the patron was constantly either applauding the performance or interfering in it and telling the performer how to perform or what to do. So the kind of music that we are used to in the name of Indian classical music today, whether it is vocal or instrumental, was not really happening at that time. Or it was, I would say, it was the time when it was just changing.
Thank you. Gauhar's entry into the studio on that Tuesday morning in Calcutta was to place her forever in the annals of world musical history. Her imposing persona and her flair in dress and manner had captivated Gaisberg completely. She had proved a shrewd businesswoman too, as Gaisberg mentions. She had demanded a handsome rupees 3000 for the recording session, and the gramophone company had agreed. While the accompanist tuned their sarangi, tabla and harmonium, a self-assured Gauhar sauntered around the room and investigated the strange device with a huge horn that was fitted on the wall. Amused by the contraption, Gauhar asked the recording expert, "Am I to sing into this, Mr. Gaisberg?" This was the era of acoustic recording, where there were no microphones to amplify the voice. There used to be a huge horn fitted on the wall into which the singer had to crane his or her head into and scream out as loudly as one could. And depending on the volume of the voice, there would be a stylus on the other end which would vibrate and cut those etches on the shellac disc.
So between 1902 to 8, the practice was that all the wax masters which were recorded in India, they would go back to Germany at a place called Hanover. By chance, suppose that the papers get lost or get mismanaged, or that's why it was made a practice that at the end of the song, that singer would announce the name in English.
You know, it was the Baijis who were the first to take the challenge of going to mass media. The so-called Gharanedar Ustads had the patronage, and they were not ready to rock the boat. So it was the wives or the courtesans who were, let's say, more technology and market friendly.
They had an advantage, because like Ustads, they were singing elaborate ragas for hours and hours and things. These were trained to sing for short while, kajri, thumri, hori, dadra. If Jamindar is happy, they can elaborate. If he's not happy, even within 2 minutes, they can put all the rang in it. And that technique of Baijis came so nicely that between 1902 to 10, these great Malkajan, Goharjan, Janki Bai, and Pyara Sahib and Mojuddin Khan, they recorded over 3,000 discs. And that became the beginning of recording industry in India.
They could see that feudal patronage was gradually waning as a support system for music. They could see the end coming. Secondly, they saw it as a means of establishing their identity in the music world. They saw it as a competitive instrument, because their relationship with their client gave them a stigma. Many of them didn't even carry their original names. They carried pseudonyms because their own identity were concealed. So it gave them an opportunity to establish their identity at a time when they suffered from virtually anonymity as musicians. While they enjoyed a good patronage because of their art, to them it was an important means of establishing themselves as individuals in their own right through their art.
Bye.
If you listen to some of the early recordings, the impact of the tabla or the harmonium and so on, it's very, very, it's hardly heard because the focus is always on the voice.
So the main horn will go to the main singer and accompanist will be brought as close as possible. And mind you, that was a problem for some ladies because Goharjan like people, they were dancing girls. They used to dance in the court and the accompanist also would dance around her. And everybody had to do it at the highest pitch which they can produce.
And also it is more, you can only have staccato music. Yeah, so the instrumentalist used a lot of right hand work. And you know, the kind of means that we are used to today did not exist. The kind of bass voices we see after the coming of the microphone perhaps did not exist. I mean, they might have existed, but they did not find favor because they could not carry through.
And you imagine a concert at Hari Vallabh Mela or somewhere where people are singing and there is no closed auditorium and huge playground, people are sitting there. Then the singer, inherently he had to shout rather than sing with all nuances. Same way the accompanist or solo player had to play the instrument with highest possible capacity. And in fact, I would say that this was a complementary to each other because they had practiced this without any microphone and amplification, and that was useful in acoustic recording. In 1925, when the carbon granule microphone came in, that time a little more space was available, and actually the gramophone recording company experts had to advise the singers and players that you don't have to shout, you don't have to beat up people, you play it naturally. And that's how now, if you listen to some of the recordings of, for example, Gangubai Hangal or Bhimsen Joshi at later stage, especially after 1930, or Narayan Rao Vyas, or some sarangi of Ram Narayan, you will see the fine nuances of as if they are singing in a concert or in your house.
You can hear the difference of playing between three generations of Vilayat Khan's family. There are recordings of Imdad Khan, his grandfather, made in around 1907, 1906, and his father's recordings, Inayat Khan Saab's recordings, made say 10 years, 15 years later. And there are of course recordings of Vilayat Khan his progeny. And not only has the repertoire changed, but even if they were playing the same repertoire, the kind of music they played with the same rags or the same compositions, it is hugely different. Everything has changed. The pitches have changed. The kind of playing has changed. Voices changed because a lot of voices which would not have been audible in a pre-microphone situation were audible today. A lot of musical devices that musicians used, could not have happened had the microphone not come in, especially in instrumental music.
The great musicians of that earlier era were not great voices. In any case, the recording technology wouldn't have delivered. You come to a later era where recording technology made it necessary for you to have a melodious voice. Otherwise, you wouldn't be acceptable. You take classic example towards the end of the 78 RPM era, and he recorded his first LP but didn't live to see it, D.V. Paluskar. Beautiful melodious voice was possible only because microphones had become refined enough to capture and deliver his music to the people. Paluskar is a classic case, and today I think is only thanks to the recording technology that Paluskar is remembered. Otherwise, by the age of 35, a musician dies, he is forgotten. I mean, he's not even noticed.
Raghupati Raghava Raja Ram Padida Bhavan Sita Ram Raghupati Raghava Raja Ram Padida Bhavan Sita Ram Raghupati Raghava Raja Ram Padida.
Yes, with the coming of the 3-minute gramophone recording, as I said earlier, a whole new audience was created, people who had never heard classical music, and this especially involved women. Because even in homes where classical music was being performed, like in zamindars' houses, or women were very often kept out of it. It was only after the gramophone box came into their homes, they could listen to the music that their men enjoyed so far.
Some of the advertisements of the gramophone company too would have the picture of a lady and her child actually trying to play the gramophone. The message there was very clear that this was also targeted at one section of the society, an important component which hitherto never had access either to learning music and performing in public was totally taboo for respected women. But also listening and accessing this music was impossible for them. So for the first time, I think the gramophone brought this music also to the households. So a lot more women musicians started emerging, even from so-called respectable families who took to performance, and it was no longer seen as something that was a social taboo.
But the stigma against their performance lasted many decades. For many decades, and it is only around the 1950s that we see the first women performers of non-courtesan backgrounds coming on the scene. In fact, their recordings happened even 10 years. It took another 10 years for them to be recorded. So social prejudices are always harder to fight. But yes, technology is a great intervention. It makes it possible.
Earlier in 70 RPM record, there was a technological limitation that within a 10-inch diameter gramophone disc, how many grooves you can put in. And because of number of grooves put in the disc, that was the limiting how much time the record will play. So it was earlier 3 minutes, 3 minutes, 20 seconds. That limitation was there for almost 50 years.
Problem or the challenge that the musicians faced with the advent of the 78 RPM was primarily based on the time slot given to them, where they were used to singing a raga for hours together, to restrict it only for 3.5 minutes, called for not only extremely highly edited singing, it did need tremendous technical virtuosity as well.
And that's how I am really amazed how these old singers have mastered this technique. The same piece which they would elaborate for 15, 20 minutes, half an hour, even 1 hour, they have to can it just in 3 minutes. So there's a basic difference between a live recording, a live performance, and a recording.
For instance, the major part of Indian classical vocal music, even instrument, is the alap portion, the slow portion. This particular piece could not be rendered because it always needed more than 4 minutes in any case. Certain tals were completely taken out because of the huge number of beats involved, thus consuming so much of time. So the tals also got restricted. The compositions themselves, one had to always render the fast compositions, the chota khayals, common understanding, understandable ragas, Bhairabi, Kafi, Khamaj, came into forefront. The rare ragas got a bit pushed behind. The Agra, the Gwalior got benefited because of their approach towards Taal and Rag.
I mean, I would take my hats off to their imagination and the speed with which they adapted themselves to that 3-minute format, because most of the recordings of the great musicians of that era, in 3 minutes, they give you the satisfaction of hearing a complete rag of a 30-minute duration.
Such was their planning that if you go the Ramkali record of 78 RPM of Fayyaz Khan Sahab, he doesn't start the record with a normal, naturally needed sa, the shadaj, but he starts with mahapa. And if you listen to the Sanyamurare of Pandit Mansoor ji, you will find that he starts with the bandish itself, where he could really do a long, beautiful alap of God Mallar otherwise. So cutting down these things, framing the whole rendition according to the need of the rag within the framework of that particular limited period was so masterly done by scores of musicians that it opened up another vista of creativity.
So obviously Indian music was being tailored for a structured 3-minute performance there, which had not happened before that. And that was to have a lasting impact. In fact, the kind of whole musical sequence we see today in classical music, whether in instrumental music or in vocal music, I think it started evolving during that time. And this started happening, and this had a huge impact on the styles of playing, on the repertoire of playing. In fact, those who claim that our music is thousands of years old, I would agree, but I would also say that the kind of music that developed in India between 1910 and 1950 did not happen in India before that. And it was only due to the coming of the microphone and the recording and the social dynamic that obtained through these technological interventions that made our music what it is today. You could not have heard a half an hour or 40-minute alap without amplification.
Music was democratized for the first time. It was brought out of the confines of kothas, the royal courts, the zamindars' salons. So that was one reason why it became such a phenomenon across the country. And to a large extent, it popularized these genres which were hitherto accessible only to a few people.
And let's face it, Bhimsen Joshi was probably not going to become a musician if he hadn't heard that 78 RPM recording of Abdul Karim Khan Sahab at the age of 13. He heard that recording in a shop and left home that night with just his clothes on to become a musician. And that era produced so many great musicians that the music of that era is really a gold mine for us to learn from. Okay, acoustically it's obsolescent, not very pleasing, but that's okay. I mean, you don't hear it for acoustic refinement. You hear it as learning experience. I mean, they're textbooks for us, and a textbook can be torn, it can be yellow, the paper can be coming off, but it's still a valuable textbook.
There is some great music in 78 RPM records, but we should not presume that those 78 RPM records represented the best or the totality of music that obtained in those times, because obviously it was a very small miniaturization of the whole music.
Or in other words, Fayyaz Khan sir would be singing for our concert in any case, and a student would be learning the slow composition. But the general trend of Indian classical music, the general gharana music, had no bearing onto this particular way of singing or thinking or rendition. That remains very clear.
But that is all we have today. So if we were to think of what music must have been, say 50 years ago or 60 years ago, we only have the 78 RPM records to go by.
No matter the later period brought about longer time frame for various other formats, the long play, the CDs and all that, still we do consider that the 78 RPMs of 3.5 minutes are priceless to us. There are many recordings which we listen to, not just for the voice of that particular artist, but definitely for the content.
With a 22-minute duration available on a long-playing record, a musician could choose to present a complete rag on one side or even split it on two sides and get a full 45 minutes available for presenting one rag.
The problems that the artist had during a shorter period of rendition was that various chapters of Indian classical music could not be incorporated. More technically, one can say a bit of alap, a bit of jor, a bit of various kinds of taan, the chutan, the vistar, different kinds of techniques, the gamakas, the means, the paltas, the various kinds of movements, the asthayi ang, the antara ang, all could be incorporated into that 22 plus segment.
We did not have this whole system of presenting a repertoire like we hear it today, you know. I mean, there were specialists, especially in instrumental music, also in vocal music, that some people only sang Tumri, some people only sang Drupad, some people only did Alap, some people only played, a kind of gat called the Masjid Khani Gat, or the Raza Khani Gat, or the Firoz Khani Gat. You know, these were all specialists who did that. You know, so suddenly everybody was playing everything, And suddenly everybody was singing everything. And they also devised this format where you had, an alap to begin with, and then a jod, and then a vilambit gat, and a drut gat, and so on.
Until the 60s, vocalists dominated the entire classical music scene. Not because we had greater vocalists than we had instrumentalists, but the instrumentalists did not have a platform, recorded platform, to present the maturity of the music. It's only in the long playing era that a near concert length recording could go out to the people with the required sophistication that instrumental music required. And the second thing that happened with the long playing era was that Hindustani music became a global phenomenon. And without the long playing record, it was impossible to conceive of the global market opening up, because it was only a concert length recording that could have given them a true feel of the entirety of the Hindustani music. And by that time, amplification electronics had achieved a sophistication which could deliver the music to them.
And some of the best music that we have recorded over the decades is found in LP music. Also, it made it possible for a whole lot of genres to become popular, and popular with new audiences. For example, the whole fetishization of Dhrupad, for example, in France or in Europe, happened with the arrival of the UNESCO series which Alanda Nilu made in the late 50s and early 60s of Moinuddin and Aminuddin Dagar. And even today I consider the long playing record as the best repository of Indian music. Another thing that impacted in the final recordings or the final product of the during the time of the LP records and the coming of the magnetic tape was the possibility that it afforded to both musicians and producers in terms of editing. All musicians would play a piece, hear it again, and then re-record it, and if they found that a certain effect was rendered better in take two, then it could be merged with parts of take one or take three, and the final recording would be produced. Very rarely, very, very rarely would I say that a musician went to the studio and recorded one piece non-stop.
Editing of music only when it has exceeded time for the format that the artist has been recorded is permissible, because that is a must. You cannot otherwise produce it. But when the editing goes on for musical purpose, there I feel it to be a bit unethical. That why didn't the artist do a bit of homework? Nothing beyond it. I know for sure, for Mallikarjun Mansoor, he has never been edited because of the tremendous sense of editing that went on in his mind while singing the piece, vis-a-vis the time given to him. I believe Pandit Ravi Shankarji also was one, such an artist.
We don't look at all the drafts of a writer's novel when we read a book, do we? So obviously the artist has the right to edit his own art. The coming of the microphone and the magnetic tape afforded him a possibility which was already there with the painter, the sculptor and the writer. So I don't see a great ethical question there. I mean, where is it said that it should be, you know, a one take performance? You do that in the concert situation in any case. But in a recorded situation, something which is going to be like a book, something which is going to last much longer than that moment of performance, what denies him the right of relooking and editing and replacing his own performance?
Whole outlook of the people changed, because then by the time the 2-in-1 tape recorders came in and the cassette came in, and now I can record anything, just press the record button, I get my copy at my home, and people are very happy, flooded with market with the cassette. And then the vinyls and LP records were slowly going out of phase, and people are wondering whether they will return anytime or cassette will just take over.
Cassettes made the difference. It not only broke the monopoly of the big companies who could invest massive amounts of capital in recording and production, it also broke the monopoly of the big artists who were created by the LPs. Interestingly, that was also the time when the first post-independence generation of musicians were coming up. Those who were just born after 1947 were coming into the market around 1970, 24, 25 year olds. They wanted an entry into the market. The cassette allowed them to enter the market. So some of them have become superstars.
Lokesh Dhawan, the owner of Synthesis Studio, had the first non-linear recording system. But it was projected that the system is very expensive. So not very many people could afford that. And afterwards, within maybe 2 years or so, tape-based digital sound recording facilities started coming in our country, and which was not so expensive. Or rather, we found out it is actually not so expensive. So more and more people adopted that. And naturally, our musicians, both classical vocalists and instrumentalists, started using that system.
Dha Kridhati Dha Kridhati Dhagena Dhun Ghena Dhagena Dha Titi Kegeta Kitene Dhagena Dhun Tun Tun Tunna Tunna Ghena Ghena Kegeta Kitene Dha Ghena 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 Dhena Ghena Dhagena Dha Titi Kata Kata
See, the digital sound recording system is a blessing, and we can do things which we couldn't even dream earlier. And you can see, actually, you can see the sound wave, and you know the preciseness of editing, and all those things are there. And there are, you know, the processors, the many kind of processors that you can use in post production, which was unthinkable before. But at the same time, there are certain aspects which we should think about, is like the extreme editing. Like, you know, you edit note by note. You can even put a single sa from one place to another. And then there's like pitch correction. You know, you can, you know, note by note, you can put low off tune onto the correct note. The question is whether or not it is ethically and aesthetically correct. There can be no discussion about it.
What is the artistic aim of Hindustani music? Is to deliver the aesthetic satisfaction of the rag, right? How is a musician judged? He is judged on the extent to which he has done justice to the character of that rag and presented the rag as a satisfying totality. If this is the main artistic aim, the pleasantness of the sound is not the main criterion by which we judge Hindustani music. As recording technology and playback technology has become more sophisticated, musicians have begun to cultivate sounds which are more pleasant because the equipment is able to deliver them.
The pleasing sound, the sound what we technically call colored sound, is the call of the day, not of this period, but last three decades maybe, if not little more. We are all concerned about not the natural acoustic sound, not the natural wind sound, but the colored sound, if you know what I mean. There we start feeling not so happy, is the fact that we don't have a Surbahar or even a Shehnai. Otherwise, Asur Bahar, Sur Singar, shehnai, pakhawaj, kind of instruments which naturally would produce such great beautiful sound, started losing out the market, and santoor starts winning the race by miles because of the ability of sound production and the way it has incorporated the technology of producing more pleasing sound, more acceptable sound.
If you ask, say, Shujaat, I will give you natural sound, I might not say, I would say, no, I don't want natural sound. I want enhanced sound where I want enhanced treble, touch of bass. If I get really good sound without just huge volume, just, and then I can give the best music. And I think with most musicians all over the world, for any kind of music, if they are given good sound, which they are happy with, then their musical output goes up by hundreds fold times.
See, everybody tries to use the capabilities of the technology to deliver a more pleasing sound. In the process, will they sacrifice the content of music? Some might not. And it all depends on what the audiences are willing to accept. If the audiences welcome a pleasant sound even without the content of music, people will concentrate on the pleasantness of the sound and mistake pleasant sounds for good music.
Is the challenge that our time is facing. How does one monetize music which is being produced? It will also determine as to whether music will survive. Of course, music will survive, but will the musician survive? Will he survive as well as he had in the 20th century? Because I believe the 20th century was the best for the musician. They had started making huge amounts of money with the coming of modern times. And Ravi Shankar and Vilayat Khan are the epitomes of that era. But today, it is, while it is very easy to get known all over the world through the internet, it is equally difficult to get people to pay for your music.
For the last 20 years, there has been a problem in the industry. No one has noticed it, but no, the companies have stopped paying artists 20 years ago. Artists were only making CDs just so that they can write on their website, I've got 100 CDs. I've got 100 CDs in the market. I've got more than 100 CDs. What difference does it make? Who is the biggest sufferers of CDs not being able to sell? Artists who are not able to perform live concerts. So, people who work hard, who have made a name for themselves and get up on stage and perform good music, they're not the sufferers.
It's a free-for-all now. The global reach of the digital media, the internet, has made it a free-for-all now. So in a sense, it is good. It gives... Earlier, I needed a recording company to go and publish my music. Today, I publish my own music. on YouTube. So it gives me a fighting chance, if my music is good, to find my own audience, if I'm good. It allows me to become a super celebrity if I'm a great musician in the making without the cooperation of any recording company.
My concern is the quality of the song, the authenticity of the product. If, say, for instance, if I had, in those days, if I had gone to and bought a record from HMV, I knew that this is an authentic piece of work and I could depend on the product. But today, you don't know whether you download one piece of music from somewhere and you don't know if you can hold anybody accountable for that piece of work. What about the studios? What about the people who are involved in the studios, the sound engineers? I think that a person, when he goes to record his piece in the studio, I mean, there are not only the artist, the other people, the sound engineer, the studio ambience, the microphone, and everything contributes in the final product. And that has, to my mind, that has a very, very important role to play in the final product of the artist. And they are getting closed down, they are getting sidelined, and a whole lot of people are getting unemployed. And I think that is what one has to think about.
It is unfortunate, but I think the music consumption has not fallen. People are using all means, whether it's including piracy and illegal means, but music per se is being consumed. So to that extent, I think it has made music more ubiquitous, more accessible, more appreciated by a larger section of people.
If one wants to talk only about the availability of music and the access to the Indian classical music, helping the students, listeners, the musicians themselves, is concerned, where we are not going into the pecuniary gain or loss. One has to admit it without any doubt, but it has helped us enormously, because even the private collectors are dying out. The equipment to play those music is not there. Let aside getting the records, we hardly find a 78 RPM machine to play a record, or even a spool recorder. It's only that perhaps the CD and the MP3s can be played, where you rarely find a gorgon. And the most important factor is that let aside having that huge collection, which is in any case not possible, even to house a portion of it would be impossible. What is possible through just the net and a PC and the click of it, and a connectivity to the UTM. It's simply amazing, one would say, the kind of music that is stored inside that small space that you have got. And shouldn't that be absolutely the good enough reason to support the advent or this thing of the technological inputs that have been given to us? Should we not consider ourselves lucky? I think we should.